السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. لله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهداه وبعد. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Complete blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless every single one of us, to bless all those who have made an effort to learn the Quran. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless all those who have completed the memorization of the Quran, everyone who intends to memorize part of the Quran, and I hope that is every single one of us, as well as those young talibat who are seated on my right and left. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant them all success and to bless us all. Honored ulama, beloved brothers and sisters, sons and daughters, if we are to speak on the Holy Quran or the Noble Quran, we would require an entire lifetime. Because the Quran is the book of the one who gave us this life. It is the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Creator. And it is impossible to do justice to this book. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent it to us in order for it to be a means of guidance for all of us. And it is important that we take it as a means of guidance. And this is why there are so many different aspects of learning when it comes to the Quran. Starting from the reading, moving on to the recitation, and the reading and reciting are two different things. Moving on to perfection of the recitation through mastering the tajweed and the correct pronunciations of the wordings of the Quran, together with how they should be pronounced when they are with one another, when different letters of the alphabet are paired or appear next to each other, they are pronounced differently at times. And one needs to master this in order to become from amongst those who are Ahlul Quran, or at least have the intention to master it and head in that direction. Also, to learn the meanings of the words of the Quran, not only the translation, but the meanings, the deeper meanings, to go into the reasons of revelation of the Quran, the verses of the Quran, to go into the rules and regulations that are derived from the Quran. And after we have learned as much as we can, putting into practice as much as we can, it is our duty to impart it to others, to teach others, solely for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And inshallah, I hope and I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us from Ahlul Quran, the people of the Quran. Why do I say that? Because those will be the VIPs on the day of Qiyamah. We heard moments ago that across the globe, in fact, not only here in South Africa, but across the globe, generally, most communities are very guilty of not paying their imams or their muadhins or their muallims and muallimat who are teaching the Quran and teaching deen, and they are guilty of not respecting them as much as they respect people who have money. And as much as they respect people who have some qualification of the dunya, when you have a heart surgeon who is one of the top surgeons in this country, and you know you've got a condition of the heart, you will make sure you befriend that person. Why? Because you know, I need this, and that is a specialist. Believe me, it is more simple to die a physical death than to die a spiritual death. It is much more detrimental for us if we have died a spiritual death than if we died physically. Because death, the definition of death when it comes to a mu'min and a person who believes, is the beginning of that life that has no ending. That's the definition of death. If we were to ask someone define death, they would probably say it's the end of life. But when you ask a mu'min to define death, they will say it's the beginning of the eternal life. And that is why if we are physically dead, we have started a life that will now never end. If we've prepared for that never-ending life, then we will be successful. But if we have not prepared for it, then doom and destruction upon those who have only prepared for this life that is about to end. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant me and yourselves the ability to strike the balance between preparation for this world and preparation for the akhirah. This Quran is a book of guidance. Remember the difference between the Quran and the previous books. It is impossible for the highest priest of any of the Jewish or Christian churches to memorize the Bible cover to cover in the way that we memorize the Quran. Not only that, one of my own ustads used to tell us that if any human being writes in their own language 2 pages with their own mind and head and heart and tell them memorize it completely, they will not be able to memorize what they wrote themselves. Because the miracle of the Quran is such that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it easy. Allah has made it easy to memorize. He has made it easy to understand. He has made it easy to put into practice because He sent it with a messenger who showed it to us. Do you know sometimes you get a manual, you get a book, and in that book they are telling you how to operate a certain gadget. If you do not have someone who is going to show you together with the book, you might think, hey, this is quite impossible. You know, they are telling us to do this on this laptop, this latest laptop. I'm trying exactly what they are saying, but it's not working. Why? Because you don't have someone who is showing you exactly how to do it sometimes. Depending on how sophisticated that gadget is, let me tell you that man is the most sophisticated gadget you could ever have. Man is the most sophisticated creature. In fact, ashraful makhluqat, the most noble, the most honored, the most honorable of all creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ Allah says, indeed we have created man in the best of postures. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given that to us. We need to thank Allah for that. And at the same time, when Allah sent Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with this book, He sent him so that nobody could come and say, we've got the book, but it's impractical. We can't practice upon it. And this is why Allah says,
لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو اللَّهَ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرَ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا
Indeed, there is a complete example within the lifetime of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for those who would like to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who are looking forward to the life after death, and so on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says they have a complete example in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The difference between this book and the other books, there are many differences, but one of them is that what happened with those books, their very authenticity is questionable and is questioned, very rightly questioned, because themselves within their own religions, they are debating as to which version is the most correct version or which version is even acceptable. There are so many versions, for example, of the Bible. We as Muslims acknowledge and accept the Bible, but not the translation of it, not the various versions that are available today. Why? Because these versions have so much difference and so much that actually negates the other versions themselves that it renders them unauthentic. So how can we accept something that within the Christians themselves they are debating? I once spoke to a Christian, with all due respect to Christians, and I said that the day the Christians can all come together and decide that this is the one version we all adopt, That's the day you can now come and talk to us as Muslims to say, right, come and accept this book. So first solve your mess in your house, then go and tell the others, here's the book. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all protection. But with the Quran, Allah says,
Inna nahnu nazzalna al-dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun.
Allah says, we are the ones who revealed this book, and we are the ones who will protect this book. And this is why moments ago when we heard that in Palestine they are protecting themselves against the enemy, or preparing themselves against the enemy by memorizing the Quran, it brought me immediately to the understanding of this verse. Let's look at it. If Allah says, I have revealed this book and I will protect it, if you make an effort to memorize that book, Allah will have to protect you. Why? Because you are part and parcel of this book. The book is not just something that has pages in it, that has lines in it, that has words in it and so on. No, it is far beyond that. It goes to an understanding, it goes to deeper knowledge, it goes to the recitation, it goes to the rules of tajweed and recitation of the Quran. It goes far beyond. It goes to holding the torch. It reminds me of an Olympic torch. It needs to be passed on, and it needs to carry on, and it needs really for everyone to have the same torch. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant that to us. So when Allah says, I will protect the book, we need to realize, in order for me and you to have that book, we need to have some Islamic qualities in us. Allah does not give that book to anyone and everyone. No. There are certain qualities that are required in a person who will then come up with that level of being Ahlul Quran, the people of the book. What are these qualities? It's important we know these qualities. Allah says in the Quran,
وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا.
We will guide to our paths only those who struggle and strive to get to that path. Whoever wants to get to the path, it's not enough for them to say, Inshallah, I want to be a good Muslim. Ya Allah, make me a good Muslim. Ya Allah, make me the best Muslim. And then they find themselves in the nightclubs and in the discos, and they don't want to adopt Islamic dress code, and they want to lie and cheat and deceive and cause problems. And they say, well, Allah's not guiding me. I make dua to Him every day. I don't know. Allah says, no. You make an effort.
وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا.
Whoever makes an effort to come towards us, Allah says, for them, we shall open the doors. So if you would like the Quran to come to you, if you want to know who is Ahlul Quran, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls them the VIPs on the day of Qiyamah, He says in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam,
يُقَالُ لِصَاحِبِ الْقُرْآنِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ اقرا وارتق ورتل كما كنت ترتل في الدنيا فان منزلك عند اخر ايه تقراها.
It will be said to a person who has the Quran on the day of Qiyamah that recite this Quran like you used to recite it in the dunya, and go up as you are completing the verse. You complete a verse, you arrive at a new level. You complete another verse, you arrive at a new level. Where you get stuck, that will be your final abode in heaven, in Jannah. So the debate is not whether or not you are going to Jannah. In fact, it will be what is the level you will get in Jannah. May Allah grant us that level. We are weak, and that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give us in writing to say, you are from Jannah, you are from Jannah, you are from Jannah, with our names and surnames. But for the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, He did it. He gave them with name and surname, you are from Jannah. Don't we know the Ashara, Al-Mubashara Bil Jannah? There were 10, there were so many others. There were 313 in the Battle of Badr. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says,
وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لَعَلَّ اللَّهَ اطَّلَعَ عَلَىٰ أَهْلِ بَدْرٍ فَقَالَ اِعْمَلُوا مَا شِئْتُمْ فَإِنِّي قَدْ غَفَرْتُ لَكُمْ.
How do you know? There is a chance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told the people of Badr, do as you please from this day on. I have forgiven you and I am happy with you. If we were told that, one wonders what would happen to the nightclubs around us. May Allah protect us. Why? Because a person knows, I am in heaven. We are so weak, we'd probably start thinking of what evil we could quickly do in the dunya before we die and make use of it. That is why we are not given by name and surname. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an elevated rank. May He protect us. However, when it comes to Ahlul Quran, it is important that we realize that inshallah, thumma inshallah, the meaning of that particular word, sahibul Qur'ani, a person who has the Qur'an. The majority of the scholars say that it is a hafiz. It is a person who has memorized the Qur'an. But I want to give you better news and good news. Sahibul Quran, according to some scholars, does not necessarily mean a person who memorized the whole Quran. But a person who memorized and knows even a little bit of the Quran is also Sahibul Quran. وَإِنْ كَانَ قَلِيلًا. So those who have memorized Surah Al-Fatiha, good news to you. Those who have memorized Surah Al-Ikhlas, good news to you. Why? On the day of Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, will tell you, you read as well. You might know less, so you'll probably stop at a lower level, but it will still get you to Jannah, inshallah. Al-Qur'anu hujjatun laka aw alayka. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, this Qur'an will bear witness for you or against you, every member of my ummah, subhanallah. So for me, I need to ask myself, and this is the lesson I will draw and I will take. How much effort do I make for the Quran? We've heard others making effort, mashallah. But myself, and the question should be asked to everyone. Everyone must ask themselves the question. How much have I done to serve the Quran and the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Can I even read it? Number one, what effort have I made to be able to read it, to try to read it? Do I even know the alif and the ba correctly? If I do know how to read it, what effort have I made to perfect the recitation? No matter how much Quran you know, you should realize there will be someone who knows more than you. It never stops. Never ever stops. In fact, subhanallah, I can give you examples, though we don't have much time, of so many different people who have learnt after they thought they knew everything. Al-ilmu bahrun la sahila lah. Knowledge is an ocean that has no coast. The minute you think you arrived at a coast by thinking that now you know everything, that means what you have is not knowledge, it is something else. Because if you truly want to study, you need to realize and understand that it will never ever stop. Right to the last breath, you will be able to perfect your Quran. You will notice something, someone will notice something. And that brings us to one of the conditions or one of the prime qualities of a person who wants to learn the Quran. Don't ever feel bad when you are corrected. Never ever get upset when you are corrected. Because if you are not corrected, subhanallah, there is no way that you will be able to progress. No way. And don't ever be embarrassed of a mistake that happens. Do you know the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was perfect? We all know he was the best of creation. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him make certain errors, not because there was anything wrong with his perfection, but because the example was to be so perfect that for us, we were meant to learn from it, that when someone who is so perfect has made a mistake, look at how they react. Who are we to react in another way? Subhanallah. So the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever he was admonished by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it was not because there was anything wrong with him. Allah made him make that error out of his divine wisdom in order for people like me and you to be able to say that when I am following the example of the messenger, it even teaches me how to correct myself when I make mistakes. Subhanallah. So one day in salah, he changed an ayah slightly. Not because, or not that the meaning changed, but there was a slight change in it. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum were silent. They were quiet. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after salah, they questioned him. They said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is it a new verse that was revealed or is it error? Subhanallah. Subhanallah. Look at the respect. Is it a new verse that was revealed or is it error? Minor thing, small item. He looked back and he asked a question. Afikum Ubay? Is Ubay ibn Ka'ab amongst you? And indeed he was. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, what's happening, O Ubay? How come you didn't correct me? You are supposed to be one of the best reciters. Imagine the Prophet is bearing witness for Ubay ibn Ka'ab radiallahu anhu. And he was quiet. He says, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you want me to correct you when it was revealed upon you? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Quran was in his heart. It was revealed into his heart.
على قلبك لتكون من المنذرين.
The beginning of that verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, نزل به الروح الأمين على قلبك لتكون من المنذرين.
جبريل عليه الصلاة والسلام came down with the Quran straight into the heart of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم so that he could be from amongst those who could warn with the Quran.
So if we would like to project this Quran, to teach it to others, we need to practice it first, and we need to make sure it's in our blood, it's in our heart, not just on our tongues. Because a lot of people sadly nowadays are concentrating on bulk production of huffaz. But we need to ask ourselves, are we treating it like a bakery where we are making mass huffaz similar to bread and suddenly turn them upside down and then find out that, you know what, this is actually burnt bread. May Allah protect us. We don't want that. What we want the maximum number, but with the quality. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not create us in order to show the quantity, but always it was for quality. Listen to what Allah says.
الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا.
Allah says, it is He who created death and life in order to test you who has better deeds. He never ever said who has more deeds. No. And that same rule applies in everything. When you are doing something, do it properly. There is a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that Allah loves those whom whenever they do anything, they do it properly. And that is why as Muslims, we firmly believe when you want to do something, do it properly or don't do it. Leave it for someone else to do. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us exception and understanding. So we look at huffaz and hafidhat. We expect a certain level of character and conduct. We expect them to respect themselves before they are respected by others. And this is something that sometimes we lack. Why? Because at times it is imposed upon them against their will to the degree that they begin to hate the Quran. May Allah protect us. Sometimes we have some children who really suffer to memorize the Quran. They will have a double reward. The hadith says, the one who recites the Quran and he can flow, he will have a reward. But the one who struggles and strives to read it will have a double reward. One is for the recitation, and two is for the great effort they put into trying to read it. So when it takes you 30 minutes to read the Quran, or should I say to read one juz, when it takes you 30 minutes to read one juz, and I would like to feel that if you want to read one juz with tajweed, if it's 29 minutes, I don't think you've actually applied all the rules. That's my own experience. Allah knows best. I know I've heard of people who finish a juz in 10 minutes and 15 minutes. Only Allah knows what barakah they have in their time that they finish it in that time. Maybe we are so sinful we don't have that barakah. I'm only looking at it from a positive point of view, inshallah. The barakah they have in their time. We are not sahaba. We are not tabi'een. We are not those people who had so much barakah in their time. But if a person takes so long, 2 hours, 3 hours, to finish 3 pages, 4 pages, wallahi, they will have a double and a triple and a quadruple reward. Why? Because they put in great effort. They loved to read it. I want to ask myself and yourselves a question. How much Quran did you read today? How much Quran did you read today? Everyone answer it themselves in their mind. I'm sure every one of us can do better. If we came to a function to celebrate the graduation of hafidhat who have memorized the Quran and we have not read one word of the Quran through the day, I think there is a problem. I think we are becoming people who are oblivious of what is our gift. What is the miracle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? There were so many miracles. One of them which remains with us today is the Quran, subhanallah. Throughout my talk, so many things are coming to my mind that only Allah knows what time we are going to finish. What time is Adhan of Fajr, ya Sheikh? So the reality is, if we take a careful look at this Quran and what happened to it, so many people have memorized the Quran without understanding it. Without understanding it, that's a miracle of the Quran. Imagine, try and pick up 3 sentences of Chinese. Wallahi, try and do this. 3 sentences of Chinese language that you do not understand. I challenge you, you will never ever be able to memorize those 3 complete sentences with their tajweed. May Allah protect us. They have a tajweed of their own. I know that and you do too. But you cannot. Why? Because there's no miracle in that language. There's no miracle. There's no guarantee from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكِرِ. We have made this Quran easy, not only to memorize, but to understand as well. Is there anyone from amongst you who's going to endeavor to memorize it and to understand it? This يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ, the word dhikr not only includes the memorization of it, but the understanding of it as well. Allah's made it easy to understand. Simple examples. The stories of the previous prophets are not fairy tales. They are examples that if 1 plus 1 was 2 500 years ago, 1 plus 1 cannot be 3 today. What that means is, when those people engaged in zina and in other sins, then they were punished in a specific way. Do we now suddenly cleverly think that when we engage in the same sins, it's not going to arrive at the same punishment? It's foolish. If this road took you from here to there 10 years ago, and the same road is there and you are following it, it will take you to the same place. So if one road led to a lion's den where the person was mauled, you would be foolish to go down the same route. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. So Allah is saying, we have made this Quran easy for you to memorize, to learn, to understand. How many of you are going to try to do that? The question still stands. What did I read today? The reality is, standing here, I'm thinking to myself, and I'm so happy you don't know my answer, that inshallah I can do better as well. And that's a fact. We are all human beings, we can do better. The Quran is a book that we have adjusted ourselves in order to understand it. So we kept it in the Arabic language, and we adjusted our own tongues. We learned the dialects, and we came up to suit the word of Allah. That's why it's there today, because that was Allah's plan. Whereas the Bible, what happened to it? It was there. The original script was there. But they adjusted the word of Allah to suit them, so they lost it. With us, we adjusted ourselves to suit the word of Allah, so we have it. The same applies to the Torah, the Talmud, and the other books. They adjusted them in order for them to understand by translating and by writing footnotes. And in the process, they lost the original. And this is why Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah have encouraged very, very strongly anyone who wants to translate the Quran, saying that put the Arabic text on one side and put your attempt to explain to man what you think is the word of Allah on the other side. So the translation of the Quran is not the Quran. Please understand that. The translation of the Quran is not the Quran. It is either Yusuf Ali's or Pictol's or any one of them's endeavor to try and explain to you what they thought was the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which means it can have mistakes, it can have differences, it can have so much discrepancy between from one to another, and it can be very, very shallow, and every translation is extremely shallow because no language qualifies to translate the Arabic language. You need to learn the Arabic language to appreciate the sweetness of the Quran, subhanallah. We read a verse, or one of the verses was read by one of the hafidhat who completed tonight. And I heard Sheikh Ihsan sitting next to me saying, subhanallah. And I knew why he said it, because he felt the sweetness of the verse and the power of it. Can I tell you what the verse was? Listen.
ربما يود الذين كفروا لو كانوا مسلمين.
Allah is saying, subhanallah, regarding the kuffar, that They want deep down, and they will want, and they have wanted, and they shall want within their hearts, either yesterday, today, or tomorrow, to be Muslimin from amongst you. Allahu Akbar. It will be within their hearts. It either was, it either is, it either will be. Subhanallah. Within their hearts, to be from amongst the Muslimin. Now when you read that verse, Allah is telling you how powerful He is and how the hearts are in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يُقَلِّبُهَا كَيْفَ شَاءَ. He turns them however He wishes. May Allah turn our hearts towards the deen. Allahumma ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qulubana ala deenik. So the reality is, we have seen here tonight that it is necessary for us to adjust ourselves to suit the Quran. How would we suit the Quran? By adopting what it is telling you. If the Quran says, وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَارْكَعُوا مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ. Establish your salah, give out your zakah, and bow down with those who are bowing. And you are not from amongst those who bow. You are not from amongst those who's regular with their salah. You look at salah as a burden. Then can you call yourself Ahlul Quran? Can you call yourself a person of the Quran when the Quran tells us, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ وَيَحْفَظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنَّ. When Allah says to the believing males and the believing females to lower their gazes, to be modest, to dress appropriately, to protect themselves, to protect their chastity, we find ourselves dressed however we want, pitching up at the madrasa that teaches Quran. What are you going to learn? Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And this is why someone who wants to learn the Quran, they will only be able to get it if firstly they understand the etiquettes of learning the Quran. The respect of the one who has taught you the Quran, you are meant to kiss them on their foreheads. Subhanallah. Why? Let me explain to you why. If you don't understand the value of the one who taught you Alif and Ba, you've wasted your time. Because when someone says, listen my dear child, Alif, this is Alif, and you say, okay, Alif, then they say Ba, Ba, you come back the next day, they test you, Alif, Ba, they scold at you, they shout you. Now comes a parent rolling their sleeves, why did you shout my child? That parent does not know that, do you know what? Allah says, for every letter, there's 10 rewards. That child learned Quran from this muallim or muallima. Every time they read Quran in their lives, there are electric shockwaves that move across the entire existence, because, wallahi, if you are to picture what I'm about to tell you, you will weep. Do you know, when I read here, the one who taught me Alif and Ba gets the exact reward I am getting for every letter as well. And not only one person, but so many people up that ladder who've taught me, who might have taught me a different art of the Quran, as I recite, they are getting the reward. Even the one who taught me Alif and Ba and Ta and Jim, and the one who helped me perfect the pronunciation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I am not stingy. I give 10 rewards for everyone. مَنْ سَنَّ سُنَّةً حَسَنَةً فَلَهُ أَجْرُهَا وَأَجْرُ مَنْ عَمِلَ بِهَا إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ لَا يَنْقُصُ ذَلِكَ مِنْ أُجُورِهِمْ شَيْئًا. Whoever has taught someone any form of goodness, they get a full reward for all that goodness. And for anyone who follows that goodness up to the day of Qiyamah, it skittles back to them all the way. Imagine who's getting the reward when I say, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Can you count how many letters there are there? I can't. So like the petrol price goes up, and we notice the petrol attendant with the meter that keeps on going so quick that before we know it, it's already sitting at 400 rands. Why? Because of a little bit of fuel. What about the amount? If there was a meter at our mouths calculating the reward that we are getting for reciting the Quran, that meter would burn out. Believe me, there's no meter that can actually calculate it. Solely Allah. And what I was saying is so electrifying is the fact that there is a chain when everybody reads, and there are millions and billions of people who read and who have read. When they read, The reward goes to the ustad, another ustad, the one who taught him, the one who taught him, the one who taught them, and the group who taught them, and the group who taught them, until it gets to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanallah, Sayyidul Anbiya. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant him that elevated rank. So I read, and every single one of us read. Imagine when we are reading salah 5 times a day. My ustad who taught me alif and ba, may Allah not make me from amongst those whose parents went to go and scold and shout, because then they are cursing themselves. But when I am reading my Quran, whether I get on with that muallim or not anymore, they are still getting rewards for having taught me whatever they taught me, subhanallah. So for your salah, the rewards are going to that muallim or muallima. For your recitation of the Quran, going to them. And from them goes to the hierarchy and so on, bringing me to another point. Where does the Quran come to? Allah speaks about nubuwa. Nubuwa is prophethood. Prophethood, Allah chooses people. Which type of people? Those whose parents and grandparents were also quite on the straight path, or had a genuine feeling towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَى آدَمَ وَنُوحًا وَآلَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ.
آلَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ means the family of Ibrahim. وَآلَ عِمْرَانَ and the family of Imran. What great people they might be. Allah says He chose Nuh, He chose Adam, He chose the family of Ibrahim, He chose the family of Imran to be messengers. And Allah says, ذُرِّيَّةً بَعْضُهَا مِن بَعْضٍ. They are progeny one after the other. Anyone who is a master in the Quran, I guarantee you, inshallah, 9 times out of 10, if you take a look at their family members, somewhere in their extended family will be another master of the Quran, if not a master, someone who had a genuine feeling for this deen. Allah does not leave them. Allah will never leave them. Let me tell you, Ibrahim alayhi salam made a dua. And he says, oh Allah, protect me and my son. Allah says, forget about you and your son, your whole progeny to come, inshallah. And Allah says, every prophet that will come after you, O Ibrahim, will be from your family, including Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Allah loved his effort so much. So let us make an effort for the deen. Let us make an effort for Islam. Let us go to the masajid. We heard moments ago that one of the grandparents, I think, every time they would be seen walking to the masjid, as Sheikh Ibrahim said, they would be seen walking to the masjid, always found at the masajid. وَرَجُلٌ قَلْبُهُ مُعَلَّقٌ بِالْمَسَاجِدِ. He is also a VIP on the day of Qiyamah, but he has entered from a different door, subhanallah. What is that door? Allah says there are certain VIPs on the day of Qiyamah. One of them will be those whose hearts are stuck and glued to the masajid. رَجُلٌ قَلْبُهُ مُعَلَّقٌ بِالْمَسَاجِدِ. And another one, رَجُلٌ تَصَدَّقَ بِصَدَقَةٍ فَأَخْفَاهَا. A person who gives out charities and they've hidden those charities. They didn't tell everyone, hey, I gave that one and I gave this one and I gave this one. And a charity, let me tell you what is an acceptable charity in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That acceptable charity is when you have hunted and looked for the best place to give it to, then you gave it. Not just anyone who comes to you, you've suddenly given them. No. But you need to hunt, you need to look, you need to see where are you fulfilling your zakah, in the same way that you have a right not to read behind an imam who's a drunkard, for example. May Allah protect us. But at the same time, if you have a human being who's a drunkard, would you like to give them your zakat? You wouldn't, because they'd buy with your zakat crates and cases of alcohol. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect myself and yourselves and our offspring and our progeny to come up to the day of Qiyamah. So those who do not respect their ustads will never learn. Those who do not dress appropriately will never learn. If they learn, it will be on the tongue, not in the heart. They might be extremely intelligent, but only on the tongue. And this is why there is a growing number of huffaz, I don't know about hafidhat, but a growing number of huffaz, sadly, who have very bad habits. Sadly, who have very bad habits. I hope it is not the case in this part of the world, inshallah. Wallahi, if we knew the level of a hafidh, we would realize we need to put them on our heads. A hafidh, according to one narration, will take with him 10 people into Jannah. who was supposed to go to Jahannam. So we better start becoming friends of the Huffaz. Really. But sometimes the Huffaz live their lives in such a way, and this is a sign of rejection, that they themselves don't even know where they are heading. May Allah not grant us all, may Allah not grant us punishment, and may He save us all from Jahannam. Another very interesting issue regarding the Quran and regarding the Huffaz and the Hafidhat is that at some stage during the memorization of the Quran, you will have shaitan come to you either once or a few times and tell you, it's too hard, it's very difficult, come on, give up. You know what, you can't make it, you will not be able to do it. It happened to most of us. I'm sure those who are Huffaz here, when they started and you are reading Surah Baqarah every day, you are looking at 29 more chapters left, and then you finish 2, and then you finish 3, you're finishing 15, sometimes you'll finish 20, and you think, I've got 10 whole chapters left. Shaitan will come to you. Why? Because Allah's plan is complete. Do you think Allah will give you the Quran when He hasn't tested you whether you are from amongst those who can fight Shaitan or not? Allahu Akbar. If you cannot fight Shaitan's temptation to leave the Quran, do you think you are going to be able to fight Shaitan's temptation when he tells you to go to the nightclub? Allahu Akbar. May Allah protect us. So Allah tests us, and He tests us in this way to say, when I'm about to give you my kalam, my book, I will ensure and make sure that you deserve it. You struggle and strive for it, and you make an effort for it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only gives it to those who have fought Shaitan. And this is why the message is, don't ever give up hope. People ask, how long? I know, because I also teach people, and I also try. My own son is actually doing hifz with me, alhamdulillah. I also try. But the parents come to you and they say, how long does it take to become a hafiz? The answer is, wallahi, anywhere between 6 months and 6 years, and sometimes 60 years. And they look at you and they say, are you making a fool of us? Well, if you think I'm making a fool of you, there's the door. Salaamu alaikum. Because the reality is, there is no fixed time to become a hafiz. Whoever thinks that it's just a fixed time thinks that it's like a bakery. You keep the bread in and the dough in for 30 minutes and you take out your bread. That's not what it is. You got to go in there. It depends on your dedication as a parent as to how long it's going to take. Or should I say, that's part of the equation. The equation is made up by several factors. And part of it is your dedication as a parent, your encouragement. Do you make that child dress properly? If you don't, subhanallah, what will happen? The child is going to learn the word of Allah, and the rest of the day they're spending it with shaitan. Is it going to happen? It can't. You are working for example, the police force in the morning, and in the night you're going to rob. Allahu Akbar. May Allah protect us. There will be chaos. So this is why the parents play a very big role. And they need to encourage their children. They need to make sure that they are dressed properly. Be exemplary. Help them to stay away from swear words and bad words by you yourselves staying away from that. Because when parents utter words, the children follow. You want a man who's uttering the best of words, or a child who's uttering the best of words, and then suddenly contaminates them a few hours later with the largest of swear words, that even the new generation have outstripped the older generation, where the older generation don't even understand what that means. They might be swearing you and you're nodding your head. Thank you very much, sir. Why? Because those are the swear words of today. Would that child ever be a proper hafiz? That child might be a burden. Because let me tell you, some of the huffaz, may Allah protect myself and yourselves, Allah says, some of the huffaz, and this is through the mouth and the mubarak mouth of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I mentioned it, Al-Quran hujjatun laka aw alayka. The Quran will either bear witness for you or against you. So if you've memorized it by tongue and you understand its verdicts and so on, and then you go against it on the day of Qiyamah, the Quran will come and say, Ya Allah, this man or this woman or this boy or this girl, let's use the example of more of older people because they are mukallaf. This person used to read every day in me, aqimus salah, atuz zakah, kunu ma'as sadiqeen, and so on, and what have you, la tanabazu bil alqab, and so on. And yet they did not read their salah. They began to backbite. They were mocking and jeering at others. So the Quran is bearing witness against us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deeper understanding. It is a powerful book. I need it and you need it. And we need to realize that those who are making an effort to teach our children the Quran are doing us a favor. It's not their duty. And it does not mean that we are paying them, that now we expect to roll up our sleeves as though there are servants in our house to come and tell them that, right, what you will do. You know, my child will only come once a week. Well, if that's the case, you know what? You'd rather just carry on. Keep your child. The stricter the school, the better. Can I tell you why? Islam is the strictest religion. There is no religion that has more rules than Islam, not even one. And that is why, and I normally give this example, when you have a government school and a private school, in most countries, the private school or the private schools have much more rules and regulations. If your sock is not in order and you don't have a garter to hold your sock up, they send you home. Why? Because it's a private school. But still, we'll pay more to send our children to a private school, though it's got so much rules and regulations, because we know that will discipline our children. The same applies when hunting for a madrasa to send your child. You would be wrong to just send your child to the madrasa that says, you know what, we will finish it in 6 months, I give you the guarantee, come bring here. Not know what is happening, that what they've already memorized, they cannot read it, then what you do is you pull brakes on what they are doing. What's the point of moving further and further and further when you don't know what's happening? There will be a lot of confusion, a lot of chaos. And the child will graduate as a big hafiz, and the day that comes when they are tested, they won't even be able to say a word. I remember I once participated in a certain international competition. I only participated in one, in Saudi Arabia in Mecca. And there was a gentleman from a certain country who was not a hafiz, and he had applied to be a participant in the full Quran. I don't know for what reason. He must be wanting the voluntary prize, or he might have wanted a free ticket to go to Mecca or what have you. And I don't even know who allowed him to get there. So every time the judge told him, and this is a fact, and we were there, every time the judge says, read from this place, he would say, Noon wal qalam wa ma yasturun, Noon wal qalam wa ma yasturun. And he kept on saying that, until the judge says, Barakallahu feek, and told him to get out. Now, what's the point of that? Maybe he might have memorized the Quran, but whoever the teachers were never ever looked at what he did memorize. They only thought, right, you memorize a page, tomorrow the next page, the following day the following page. It does not work like that in the Quran. The Quran, when you have memorized the Quran, it is a responsibility for the rest of your life. إِنَّهُ لَأَشَدُّ تَفَصِّيًا مِنَ الْإِبِلِ فِي عُقُلِهَا. The Quran can run away from you quicker than a camel can run away from you. A camel that is tied can run away from you. So, meaning Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is giving the example that those who've just memorized the Quran paying lip service, it will run away from them, it will go away from them. They won't even understand anything, they won't even know anything. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those who can do muraja'ah. Muraja'ah meaning the revision of whatever we've learnt on a regular basis, inshallah. And may He make us from those who perfect the Quran. Imagine if you are called up on the day of Qiyamah, Sahibul Quran, O person of the Quran, and you walk with all the people, subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us Jannah. I think Fajr is drawing close. But at the same time, let me inform you that wallahi, the idea of this evening is to motivate myself and yourselves regarding the Quran. And we need to understand that the next question we have for ourselves, how much have I done to understand the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What have I done to understand the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? I can do more. Every single one of us can do more, because that is Allah's kalam. It is the word of Allah. Imagine when we pass away, Allah will meet us. Do you know what the hadith says? The hadith says, مَا مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ إِلَّا سَيُكَلِّمُهُ رَبُّهُ لَيْسَ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَهُ تُرْجُمَانٌ. Every single one of you, Allah will talk to you directly without anyone in between. Every single one of you, Allah will talk to you directly without anyone in between. We believe that, subhanallah. So we need to realize that if Allah is going to talk to us directly, surely we can't just leave His book. And we can't just say the day we go to Him that, you know, you sent a book, but I knew how to read it, but I never know what happened there. Allah says, well, that's your whole life you wasted. Subhanallah. So let us make an effort, inshallah, to memorize the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And not only to memorize it, but over and above that, to understand it. And even if we haven't memorized all of it, let's try and understand it. Whenever you have a sheikh within your locality having a lesson of tafsir, a lesson of the Quran, go and attend. I told you, really, and the lesson is for me as well. Laziness is from shaitan. Shaitan wants to drive us away. We attend functions of this nature in order to come closer to Allah, not in order to go further away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if we don't make an effort to go out to learn, it will be absolutely impossible for us to progress spiritually. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really and truly grant us all acceptance on this eve. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant Madrasa Darul Furqan and all the other madaris, inshallah, elevation. Those who are doing work for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala genuinely, may Allah grant them upliftment. Those who are lacking in sincerity, may Allah grant us all sincerity, inshallah. And may He be pleased with all of us. And subhanallah, you know, they say that when you have a cough, some of you might know the example. When you have a cough, the doctor gives you cough mixture. You can't have the whole bottle one time and say, right, I'm going to get better. It will make you worse because now you will suffer something else. You got to have a tablespoon at a time maximum. And if you really like the taste of Benylin, then you can have 2 tablespoons, inshallah. But that's the maximum. I think for tonight, I've given you 2.5 tablespoons. And we'll leave the rest for later. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Astaghfiruka wa atubu.